es cierto.
So I thank all of you for coming here today evening for this program. I'm grateful to be here with you. As was mentioned, I'll speak on discover your inner power. This talk will be partially autobiographical and partially analytical. Because in a sense, all of us in our life are searching for power. We all have desires, we have dreams, and we need power to implement those dreams. If we have to do some research, we may want some funds for that, that is financial power. You know, if we want to develop some habit, we need some willpower for that. So, in fact, the whole of scientific advancement has been a search for power. Francis Bacon, who is one of the pioneers of the empiricism that underlies science. So Bacon famously said that knowledge is power. Now, when after Einstein postulated the interchangeability of matter and energy with his famous E=mc², when first time the atom bomb was tried out, it was tried out on an island in the Pacific Ocean, and practically when the explosion took place, the island disappeared. It just ended. It was tried in America, it was tried there also. And eventually, of course, it was used in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And the idea that, you know, something so microscopic that we can't even see with our eyes, that can contain so much power as to remove from our sight a huge city. That is one of the most intriguing, at the same time one of the most unnerving discoveries that we have come through to modern science. That there is so much power there within this universe. And one of my interests, since my childhood was astronomy. I used to have my own telescope and look at the stars. So once I was looking at the stars, and I was looking at, and after half an hour, I realized that I didn't remember what I had seen. At that time, it struck me that although my eyes were looking at the stars, now I had been caught with the thoughts in my own head. And those thoughts, they had just grabbed my consciousness, and I was not even aware of something that was very interesting for me, the stars in the sky. So it just passed in my head, could it be that the stars out there I'm so interested in, could it be that the thoughts inside my head have so much power that they can drag me away from something that interests me? It's quite often that when something bores us, if you're studying and you're not interested in a subject, we're reading a book and after 1 hour, we find that we're still reading the same page. Sometimes you may see in a movie, you know, a boy and a girl are trying to have a relationship, and the girl is trying to show no interest. She pretends to read a book. And then the boy comes and says, you have held the book upside down. So he's held the book just as an excuse. She's not seeing only what is there. So the point is that when we are not interested in something, or we are interested in something else, then what is in front of our eyes, we don't notice it. So the thoughts inside us are also a big universe in themselves. And our capacity, science has enabled us to discover enormous amounts of outer power. And we are learning to tap this power more and more. At the same time, our capacity to discover any power or to tap any power, that depends primarily on our capacity to focus our consciousness, to be distracted, is to be disempowered. I may have, somebody may have the buttons to press by which they can just destroy the enemies who are attacking. So press one button, a huge bomb will explode over there. But if they're distracted by something else, they don't see, they don't press the button. They won't be able to use that bomb. And the enemy hits in that fraction of a second. So for tapping any power that we have, we need the power of our consciousness. Now, consciousness is among the biggest puzzles in science research today. In the Science magazine, on its 125th anniversary, published an issue in which they talked about major unanswered questions in science. So the second question in that was, where does consciousness come from? The first question was, where did the universe come from? The second is, where does consciousness come from? So now, consciousness is something which every one of us is right now aware of. At the same time, the consciousness is something for which we have no scientifically measurable parameters. Now we can say whether a person is conscious or unconscious by measuring the brain waves. But the brain waves are a symptom of consciousness. They are the result when consciousness is present. The brain waves themselves are not conscious. We could very well create an instrument which could produce waves similar to the brain waves, the similar level of frequency, but that would not have consciousness. Now, consciousness is the fundamental reality. It is because we are conscious that we can do scientific research. It is because we are conscious that we can discuss about the nature of consciousness. The chairs on which you are sitting, they exist, but they don't know that they exist. So consciousness is simply the power of self-awareness and awareness of the things around us. And this consciousness, it is a great mystery, because if we consider matter, if we go down from the physical objects that we see to their building blocks, we can go down to atoms, we can go down to subatomic particles, we can go down to quantum waves. Whatever level we go down, we won't find consciousness anywhere. Consciousness is of a fundamentally different nature. And there is definitely some correlation, but that correlation is like if I have a clock over here. The clock shows me time, but the clock is not time. If I have a clock here, the clock is not time. If I break the clock, say if I have a deadline, say if I like to just ramble along and speak for a long time, and say Naveen has told me to finish by 7:45, and I don't want to finish by 7:45, so I take a stone and hurl it at the clock, and the clock cracks, and the clock will never show 7:45. I think I can go on speaking. You know, I can break a clock, but the clock is not time. Time will keep flowing on. So similarly, consciousness is associated with the body. Consciousness manifests through the brain. So if the brain is damaged, people's capacity to function is impeded. But consciousness of a different quality. Now, here I'm not going to go into the scientific technicalities of what consciousness is and what consciousness is not. Our focus is more pragmatic. Our consciousness, some people may say that, you know, consciousness is nothing. Actually, there is no such thing as consciousness. You know, because at the material level, we can't explain consciousness. Some people say there's no consciousness. That's what many reductionists try to do. However, the very act of denying consciousness is an act of affirming consciousness. when I say I say consciousness doesn't exist. No, this chair can't say consciousness doesn't exist. Because to say consciousness doesn't exist, you need consciousness. So the very denial of consciousness is an affirmation of consciousness. So consciousness is a fundamental reality. But our focus is on how to tap it. So our inner power, at one level, I said is the power of our consciousness. But it is not just the power of our consciousness. Consciousness is something we always have. Even a person who is distracted, they also have consciousness. But instead of focusing on what they need to focus on something else. Now, we may have an exam in a few days you want to study. But suddenly, say a notification pops up on Facebook, on our phone, and we look at it. Look at one notification, another. And if I had 1 hour for study and 1 hour is gone. So during the whole 1 hour, we were conscious. But the power of our consciousness was distracted. Now, researchers have found that there are often things which we do unconsciously. Unconsciously means that we are not, they are below the threshold of our awareness. And unconscious decisions are often unhealthy decisions. So for example, say somebody decides to diet. No, from today I'm going to eat healthy food. And then, say they're working on the table, and below that there's a drawer. And in that drawer, on one side is a healthy snack. Maybe it's a salad or fruit. On the other side, there is a fatty snack. Now, if they're conscious, if they're aware, okay, whenever they get, they start feeling hungry, whenever they get a snack attack, no, a desire for a snack attacks them, and they get a snack attack, at that time, if they're aware, oh, I'm hungry, let me take this healthy food. And they will go towards the fruit and eat the fruit. But they're busy surfing on the net, maybe talking on the phone, replying to some message, and at that time the snack attack comes. And even without their awareness, the hand will go to that unhealthy snack. And then they'll start eating it. And then maybe some friend comes along and says, hey, you had planned not to eat that? Oh, yeah, I planned not to eat it. What happened? So when we are not conscious, what happens is we do things on autopilot. So all of us have, just like a machine, it's like a computer or a phone, has certain default settings. Like that, we also have certain default settings for our behavior. And when we are not conscious of what we are doing, we tend to act according to our default settings. So, if those default settings are not optimal, if those default settings are not the best for us, then even without our conscious contemplation, even against our resolution, we end up doing something which we had decided not to do. And we don't even realize it. A few months ago, on New Year, I was invited to a talk show in India about New Year resolutions. And there, and I quoted a survey, how 90% of the resolutions that people make on New Year, the resolutions are not new. They made the same resolutions last year, and they stay for some days, and after that they just dissolve. So what is happening here is that our consciousness, when it functions according to autopilot, according to its default settings, then it sabotages our good intentions. It sabotages our resolutions. So tapping our inner power. Our inner power is not just the power of our consciousness, it is the power of becoming conscious of our consciousness. Now, what am I thinking right now? Now our mind works according to a basic psychological principle. the principle is that whatever gets our attention gets us. Whatever gets our attention gets us. So nowadays we are in the world of high tech. So imagine, say, we are surfing on the net and suddenly some pop-up window comes up. The pop window pops up and it shows some link, some description. Now we may decide, I want to click on it or I don't want to click on it. If we click on it, we go to that. And then maybe another pop-up comes up. Sometimes we are reading one thing, if we are looking at some images on Google Images. Along with that, there are maybe 20 other related images. We look at that, maybe click on that. And people can just get lost. Now imagine if there was some technology which didn't require us to click. If that technology sensed whatever we were looking at. So if I'm reading a page and I see a link on the side, just look at it and automatically that link expands. And that link expands and the page opens up. And I'm reading it and I see another link. As soon as I look at it, that link opens up. Now, if there were some technology by which whatever we looked at, that link started opening up, now we could be endlessly consumed by our computer. Just go on and on and on and on. Actually, our mind is like that. You know, we may be doing one thing, suddenly a thought pops up. Maybe you can check what is the latest update on Facebook. Go there, look at that, and as soon as I look at that, I had sent a message to that person, that friend, I've not replied till now, let me check that out. So as soon as a thought comes in, if we give that thought our attention, then the thought starts growing. It keeps growing till it consumes our attention, and then when it consumes our attention, then it impels us to action. So there is a snowball effect of thoughts in our consciousness. And if a snowball is on top of a hill, initially it's as small as a pebble. At that time, if the pebble starts rolling down from the top of the hill, somebody can just kick it with their toes, it'll crack apart. But as the snowball keeps coming down, 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 it acquires more and more snow around it. It becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. And by the time it comes down, it may become like a giant boulder. And even a fully grown up human being, they be bowled over by that, flattened by that. What happened? That same snowball just acquired more and more snow. Like that, same way, when the thought first comes in our mind, we are doing one thing, another idea comes in our mind, another thought comes. That time, it's just like a tiny snowball. Now, the more we give attention to it, as we give attention to it, that attention energizes it. Like the snowball keeps becoming bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And as it keeps becoming bigger and bigger and bigger, it imposes more and more force on us. And just as the snowball that has come down will knock us down, similarly, as the thought keeps growing, 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 growing in our consciousness, it impels us to action. And we just don't realize, hey, why did I do that? So we did that because when the thought came, we were not conscious. We allowed that thought to grow, 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 and it became huge. That the consciousness that we have. Now, that consciousness is never lost in the sense that we are always conscious. But we are not always conscious of that which is important for us, that which we want to be conscious of. Especially problematic is, say, resentment. Someone says something to us. Someone does something to us, and then we feel hurt by that, we feel angered by that. Something goes wrong, and then we become resentful. Why did he do that? Why did she do that? Why did that happen? Now, imagine if someone were driving a car, and while driving a car, somehow they hit a pothole. And so, I don't know, in American roads, do you have potholes here?
Yeah, okay.
In India, in the rainy season, a lot of potholes are there. So often, so here also, say if you hit a pothole, and then now, if you hit a pothole, if that's a regular road we are going along, you may look back at it and say, okay, where did the pothole? We may just pull over or slow down and look back. Okay, that pothole, how did I not notice that pothole? We can look at it and learn from it. Okay, this is here. In future, I just go this way. We can learn, if you can look back carefully, we can avoid the pothole. But imagine somebody, they see the pothole. Where did that pothole come from? How did I hit that pothole? What, how stupid, how lousy the roads are. How careless I am. And they keep looking at the back. And they're driving on. If somebody keeps looking back and driving on, that's the recipe for disaster. We would never do such a thing, such a dangerous thing. Keep looking back while driving on. But unfortunately, that is what we are doing when we are succumbing to resentment. Something has happened, something has gone wrong. There's a difference between learning from the past and living in the past. Learning from the past means, it's like if I'm driving, I hit a pothole, I pull, maybe slow down, pull over, look at the road, okay, how, and understand how I missed the pothole, learn from it and move on. But living in the past means that I just keep that same event, whatever they did, whatever happened, we just allow it, we just go on auto-playing in our mind again and again and again. As it keeps going on and on and on, it just sucks our energy. Now, whereas when we are driving a car, we can stop the car. The difference is if we consider our life to be a journey, we cannot stop life. Life is going to move on. So if we are consumed by the past, why did she do that? Why did he do that? How did that happen? Or even, why was I so foolish? How did I do such a thing? Whatever it is. If we are consumed by that, that is exactly like we're looking back while driving on. And when we're looking back and driving on, we are going to get into further trouble. So this way, when we don't tap the power of our consciousness, then we are conscious of things which we needn't be conscious of. And we are not conscious of the things which we should be conscious of. While I'm driving, I have to be conscious of what is ahead. So if I am living, I have to be conscious of what am I to do right now. Not what happened and why it happened. Yes, there's a time and place for looking back at the past and learning from the past. But just letting the past replay again and again and again in the mind, that is not learning from the past, that is living in the past. And that is useless. Not only is it useless, it is dangerous. And thus, we end up wasting a lot of time and energy and getting into further trouble because of what happened in the past. So if our consciousness is not, if we are not tapped the power of our consciousness, then whatever opportunities we have to do things, we are unable to do them because our consciousness is elsewhere. So what do we do for this? How do we tap our inner power? We all have our feelings. Sometimes we feel good about doing something. Sometimes we don't feel good about doing something. And our feelings are important. At the same time, our feelings are never the reliable basis for decision making. Because our feelings are very fickle. Today, I've chosen a particular career and I feel this is promising. I want to study, I want to achieve. Tomorrow I come to the same class, it's boring. Oh, I made a big mistake, I should have chosen some other career. Why did I choose this field? So our feelings are fickle. So we have to understand that our feelings are like our mental weather. It's like we have a social weather, the environmental weather, it keeps changing. It's not that, say, if we don't like cold very much, we like warmth. It's not that, you know, if every day we have to go to office, we start thinking, oh, today it is cold here, I'll not go here. I'll go to wherever it is warm today. No. The weather may change, and if the weather changes, it causes some discomfort to us. But we don't let our intentions be determined by the weather. We may adapt accordingly, but we don't just change our intentions according to our weather, the weather. So just as the external weather keeps changing, and yet if we are to achieve something, we have to keep our intentions unchanging. Similarly, our mental weather also keeps changing. And ultimately, our inner power is the power of conscious intention. You all have intentions, but when the weather, when the inner weather changes, so I have my intention, say, I want to study, I want to do this, I want to do that, this is my intention. But then within us there is the intention, and within us there is also our mental weather. When the mental weather changes, today I feel, ah, this is great, I want to do it. Tomorrow I feel, I don't want to do it. Now it applies to everything, not only our career, our profession, it applies to our relationships also. Today my mental weather is good, I feel, I can't live without you. And tomorrow the mental weather says, I can't live with you. It's complete change. So what is happening over here? Our mental weather will keep changing. And we have to recognize that our mental weather, my mental weather is not me. I am my conscious intention. So whatever intention we have to do things, that intention, if we are thought out carefully, deliberated on it, and then focused on it, that if we identify with the conscious intention, we will be effective. If we identify with the mental weather, we will be distracted, we'll be ineffective. Just like if I'm working on a computer, I'm reading something. So I came with the computer to read, maybe I have to do some research, to find something on the internet to read it. I came with that intention. That is my intention. At the same time, whichever site I go, often there are maybe 20 other links. Some ads are there, some other things are there. Now they are like the mental weather. Now, if we have come to read one particular thing, we have to remember, this is what I came for. And if we perceive that, we'll be able to read that and do whatever we learn, whatever we need to learn. So the art of tapping the inner power is the art of learning the difference between our intentions, our conscious intentions, and our circumstantial emotions. Our conscious, purposeful intention. This is what I had decided to do in my life. And our circumstantial emotions. And spiritual wisdom, spiritual practices, they ultimately are meant to enable us to hone in on our conscious intention and to put aside our circumstantial emotions. The whole process of meditation is actually meant to focus on this unchanging core intention. And the circumstantial emotions will come and go. We don't focus on that. There are various forms of meditation. Their ultimate purpose is this: to shift the consciousness from the changing to the unchanging. Among various forms of meditation, one of the most potent is mantra meditation. Mantra is a spiritual sound. It is similar to an affirmation. When we do some affirmation, things will be okay. Let me not worry. Whatever affirmation you make, I'm going to be calm today. I'm not going to let this person get me worked up. Whatever the affirmation I make. Now, when we are doing an affirmation, what are we doing? We are trying to focus on the conscious intention. Now we may make our own affirmations and we may affirm them repeatedly. And the affirmations do help. They focus our mental and our consciousness on that affirmation. So that the circumstantial emotions that come, we don't get caught by them. We don't misidentify with them. We don't let ourselves be misled by them. So, but mantra is like a spiritual affirmation. When we chant the mantra, we are, by the chanting of the mantras, returning to our roots. We are reminding ourselves of who we essentially are and what our purpose is. And just by the repeated utterance of mantras, by these spiritual affirmations, we come back. We come back to our core intention. And then the circumstantial emotions that are there, they will no longer distract us. And the process of spirituality, which involves studying spiritual books, which involves coming for a spiritual program, which comes for doing some kind of spiritual meditation or spiritual affirmation, all of it is not something abstract. It is something very tangible. Tangible in terms of our inner world. So, scientists have made many remarkable discoveries, which has transformed the world around us. However, the discovery of our inner power is something which we alone have to do for ourselves. And nobody else can tap your inner power for you. Nobody else can tap my inner power for me. Ultimately, we are individuals. And we, each of us, individually have to embark on this spiritual journey, wherein we learn to tap the power of our conscious intention. Now, the conscious intention has phenomenal power. If you can just focus on a particular thing, relentlessly pursue it, we can do things which you would have otherwise thought as difficult or even as impossible. Just as sun rays, when they are concentrated, you know, if you have a magnifying glass or a concentrating paper, they concentrate that. If you have a lens through which you concentrate sun rays can burn paper because they are concentrated. Otherwise, the sun creates general warmth, but it can't create a burning temperature. If we tap the power of our inner conscious, tap our inner power of conscious intention, and whatever it is we need to do, we can enhance our capacity to do it. We all have different abilities in our life. And we often do a lot to hone our abilities. Somebody has musical talent, they may go to some courses to learn music. Somebody has, say, athletic talent, they may have a coach and they may do workouts to improve it. So we all work to hone our abilities. And that's important. Spirituality enables us. Spirituality increases our ability to tap our ability. Whatever abilities we have, you know, we will not be able to tap them if we are not conscious, if we are not attentive. If a sports player, say if a baseball player is batting, and when the ball comes, suddenly a fan shouts somewhere, and the player gets distracted, and the ball just whizzes by. Then maybe a very talented hitter of the ball, they will miss it completely because consciousness is not there. Sometimes in sports, some players, they're very temperamental. When pressure comes, they choke. And then they just can't perform. They have ability, but because there is no internal stability, they're not able to focus on the intention. They get caught by the emotions. Oh, such a big match, such an important hit. What if I miss? What if I miss? What if I miss? What if I miss? By that, they end up missing. So, for any ability that we have, the ability to tap the ability is based on the capacity of our conscious intention. So, by spirituality, we enhance our ability to tap our ability. So, I'll summarize. I spoke today about discovering our inner power. And I started by talking about how science has discovered remarkable amounts of power even something as tiny as an atom, there's so much power that can destroy an entire visible city or even an island. So by tapping power, we can do lots of things. And just as science gives us access to many powers to which we did not have access to earlier, spirituality gives us access to the most fundamental power by which we can access all other powers. That is the power of our consciousness. A person, a soldier on a warfield may have a powerful weapon which he can just destroy the attacking enemy. But if that soldier gets distracted by something and they don't press the button, then before they can destroy, the enemy may destroy them. So to be distracted is to be disempowered. Our consciousness is our fundamental power, which enables us to tap all other external powers. And this consciousness is a scientific mystery. It's a scientific reality in the sense that without the reality of consciousness, no science will be possible. But scientifically, what it is, it's a mystery. Actually, even those who deny consciousness doesn't exist, to say that, they need consciousness. The denial of consciousness is also an affirmation of consciousness. And we discussed about how do we tap the power of consciousness? Talked about how unconscious decisions are often unhealthy decisions. If I'm not conscious of what I'm eating, I'll end up eating something unhealthy, which I had resolved not to eat. So why is that? Just as our device has some default settings. So like that, our mind also has some default settings. And those default settings are often unhealthy. So if we are not conscious, then we function by those default settings and we either underutilize ourselves or we abuse ourselves, we hurt ourselves. So one example of how the default setting can hurt us, the mind and autopilot can hurt us, is through resentment. A person is driving and they hit a pothole, they can look back to understand how I can avoid the pothole in future. But if they keep glaring back at the pothole, they will meet with an accident. Similarly, when we are going the journey of life, sometimes things go wrong, people hurt us. But if we are not careful, our mind goes into an auto replay loop. Why did he do that? And then why? That resentment consumes our energy. It's like we are looking back while moving forwards. Instead of learning from the past, we end up living in the past. And we miss the present opportunity and we make problems worse for us. So how do we tap our consciousness? Actually, for that, we need to know that there is inside us much that is not really us. It's like we have whatever gets our attention gets us. So there are often circumstantial stimuli that just pop up in our head. While working on a computer, suddenly a stimuli might, suddenly a pop-up window might come up. If I click on it, I just follow it up and I just get one after another get distracted. So like that, in our mind, thoughts pop up. Just because something has popped up inside us, that does not mean it is mine or it is important for me. Whatever gets our attention gets us. And therefore, we have to be careful about what gets our attention. So just as the social, just as the environmental weather keeps changing, our mental weather also keeps changing. If we let a thought or a feeling consume our consciousness, then by a snowball effect, that which could have been neglected very easily, that overwhelms us. And then we are forced to do things which we had decided not to do. So by tapping our power of our consciousness means we learn to differentiate between our conscious intention and our circumstantial emotions, and focus on the conscious intention. So meditation, as well as specifically mantra meditation, which is like a spiritual affirmation that helps us to focus on our intention and put aside the circumstantial emotions. And when we are able to do that, then whatever abilities we have, you know, if we don't have the right temperament, if we're not able to stay calm, focused, then we won't be able to use our abilities. So our ability to tap our ability is enhanced by our spirituality. Now, by tapping the power of conscious intention, each one of us can bring out the best within us and develop ourselves to the fullest potential and fulfill our destiny. Thank you very much.